We have that end of the year kind of vibe going on here with everybody kind of chit-chatting and having a good time and catching up and getting ready for the summer. But so with that, so we can get ready for the summer and we can launch off in the summer, let's get the meeting started. Just shake it out. There you go. So do we do this to start the meeting? All right. So we are live captioning our meeting. Please look at the chat window of the WebEx meeting where you will find a link. Please click that link to open a web page with the live captioning. So call to order. Good evening. I'd like to call to order the public hearing for the Maricopa Community College County Community College District Governing Board of June 25th, 2024. For the record, I'll do a roll call vote of the board members. Before I do that, Ms. Jacqueline Smith will not be able to join us tonight. Ms. Bittersmith was going to try to join online. Ms. Bittersmith, are you there? Okay. And Dr. Gonzalez, our chancellor, is also going to join us tonight online. Dr. Gonzalez, are you there?
I am here, Dr. Narini.
Yay! You can call me Dr. Board Member. Okay, so Lynn Burnett?
Here.
Ms. Bittersmith? Ms. Butler?
Present.
Donna Davis?
Here.
Jacqueline Smith? Marie Sullivan?
Present.
Dr. Thor?
Present.
And myself. So together we have a forum. We are here to take and read public comments regarding the proposed budgets for the Gateway Early College High School fiscal year 2024-25 and Phoenix College Preparatory Academy fiscal year 24-25. The Charter High School Grants Officer is here in place of the Superintendent, Mr. Stacy Boyd. Ms. Machado, thank you for joining us. Hey. Before we get into too far of detail, I'm going to ask Ms. Grenier to come up and comment on the recent state budget that was passed as it affects our charter schools.
Thank you, Dr. Narini. Members of the board, Dr. Gonzalez, members of CEC, colleagues and guests, I am Kim Granillo and I serve as the Vice Chancellor for Business Services. I just wanted to provide a couple of comments around the charter school budgets. Anybody who tuned in last 2 weeks ago when we did agenda review and did preliminary approval of the budgets, I made comments to the effect that the state had not passed its budget yet. So the information contained in the budget that was reviewed 2 weeks ago and again today does not include any changes that the state made through their budget process. Since that meeting, they did pass the state budget. There are minor impacts to the charter school budgets for both of the high schools. For Gateway Early College High School, the total impact is just under $62,000 and on a $3 million budget. And for Phoenix College Preparatory Academy, the impact is $45,000 on a $2.3 million budget. There are two buckets of money that ADE still has that they have not allocated yet to supplements. And so we will not know until the state or until ADE determines what to do with those dollars. But what will happen from here is that there are certain criteria that if it's met, the state requires us to come back to you all with a budget amendment. And so as those allocations are made, as we look at these $2 amounts that impact the differences, if we need to, we'll come back in September with an amended budget. So by and large, there are not likely to be huge changes to the budget that you saw 2 weeks ago and that you have in front of you again this evening. I'm happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions? Ms. Macias, thank you so much. Do we have any public comments? So no public comments. And so are there any comments from any of the board members? Nope. Hearing none, I will now adjourn the public hearing for the Maricopa Community College District. And this concludes the public hearing portion of our meeting, and we'll now continue to our regular board meeting. Back to it. We are live captioning the regular board meeting. Please look in the chat window of our WebEx meeting where you will find a link. Please click on that link to open a web page with live captioning. So I call the order. At this time, I'd like to call the order a regular board meeting for the Maricopa County Community College Governing Board for June 25th, 2024. For the record, I will now call roll of the board members. Ms. Bittersmith, have you joined us yet? Okay, Ms. Smith will not be here. Mr. Burnett?
Present.
Ms. Butler?
Present.
Ms. Davis?
Present.
Ms. Smith? Dr. Thor?
Present.
Ms. Sullivan?
Present.
And myself. So that's five. So we have a quorum. So we'll start by, please join me with the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, to God, indivisible, with justice for all. Thank you. So we have three substitutions tonight. Dr. Deborah Harding, Vice President of Academic Affairs for Dr. Greg Peterson from Chandler Gilbert. Ms. Tamara Gagnon. Yeah, good. Associate Chief Human Resource Officer for Dr. Georgette Kelly, Chief Human Resource Office. Mr. Jim Curtin, Senior Associate General Counsel for Ms. Janice Folkenberg, our General Counsel. This is July or June, so we have no student life reports. So we'll move right on to the Faculty Executive Council report. Dr. Ramona Goff.
Dr. Narini, members of the board, Chancellor, CEC, colleagues, and guests. I'd like to begin tonight's report with a poem, Lilacs. Lilac smells like a warm breeze in the summertime. Lilac looks like the last seconds of a beautiful sunset. Lilac tastes like the candied blueberries in my family's blueberry pie. Lilac sounds like a small child's laughter as she barrels through the grass. Lilac moves like the lake water over small pebbles in mud. Lilac means comfort, family, and peace. Lilac feels like home. This poem was written by a 13-year-old member of SEC Professor Kim Sabin's Creative Writing Camp for aspiring authors in the 8th to 12th grade.
Nice.
James Thurlow Adams said, "There are obviously two educations. One should teach us how to make a living and the other how to live." Tonight, I'd like to spotlight faculty who meld these two forms of education. The Kids and Teens College at Estrella Mountain offered summer workshops that allowed participants to learn skills and hobbies to prepare them for the future. Students ages 13 to 18 took Cake Decoration 1, Cookie Decoration 1, Cookie Decoration 2, and a bit of anomaly, Whodunit, a crash course in forensics. Boys and girls in the 3rd through 8th grade can participate in Chandler Gilbert Community College's Hoops Summer Camp conducted by Steve Silsby. The basketball camp will be held next week on the Pecos campus. Across the district, music faculty offered opportunities for young musicians to hone their crafts. Scottsdale Community College hosted two music camps. Middle School Strings Camp, where 19 students, 7 of which returned from last summer, worked to improve their musical skills on the violin, viola, cello, and bass. And High School Strings Camp, where 19 students, 13 of which returned from last summer, received daily instruction from master musicians, providing an intense study of strings techniques while rehearsing regional and all-state excerpts. Paradise Valley Community College offered 4 free music camps for students 12 and 18 years old, songwriting and recording camp, electronic music camp, jazz camp, and music theater camp. In addition, for anyone 12 years and older, regardless of skill, PVCC music department, faculty, and guest artists hosted free rock band and jazz jam sessions. Monday night's headbangers brought their instruments and played mostly metal songs like Cowboys from Hell by Pantera, while on Wednesday nights, performers rocked out to classic rock songs like Barracuda by Heart. On Tuesday and Thursday evenings, PVCC jam sessions provided a way for jazz musicians to practice and refine their ability to listen to and spontaneously create music. At Mesa Community College, 130 students who love to sing, act, and dance enrolled in the Magic Musical Theater workshops. The Magic of Musical Theater Workshop 1 was an intense 2-week workshop designed for 5th to 12th graders, where each participant was able to perform in both large and small ensembles. Magic Music Kids was a 2-week musical theater workshop for K through 4th graders. Through the use of Broadway show tunes, singing techniques, choreographed movements, and creative drama were explored. These are just some of the quality summer programs offered in the district, but this is not the most important part of the report. In order to provide these summer opportunities, there had to be extensive collaboration. For example, Coach Silsby will be joined by additional members of his coaching staff, as well as current Coyote players, in conducting the Hoop Summer Camp. And those Tuesday and Thursday night jam sessions at PVCC were led by Keith Kelly, PVCC music faculty, Adam Roberts, Chandler Gilbert music faculty, and Eric Rasmussen, Scottsdale music faculty. Some colleges even collaborated with members of the community at large. Gateway Community College is partnering with the Boys and Girls Club to host a week-long summer boot camp of the trades programs. The camp will include welding, CNC, collision repair, and HVAC departments, and will allow participants to experience a day in school learning the trade. Similarly, Scottsdale Community College hosted Summer Salt River Junior ACE program, where 38 energetic and enthusiastic 5th through 8th graders from the Salt River Schools or the Pima Maricopa Indian community engaged in a bridge program that provided cultural and college-related experiences. I would be remiss if I didn't acknowledge the adjunct faculty who worked side by side with residential faculty to provide these learning opportunities, and staff who worked behind the scenes to provide the infrastructure and needed support. Summer camps and workshops provide for learning, growth, and fun that complement traditional education. An added benefit is that they provide an opportunity to introduce young people to all that our colleges have to offer. Faculty and our adjunct and staff partners understand this importance and work together to make it happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Makes me tired just listening to all that. Next, we have the Adjunct Faculty Association report with Ms. Kim Boche. Boche.
Beige, except with an O.
Okay.
And as I've said before, I'm not a beige person. Good evening. Good evening, Dr. Dorini, esteemed governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, and other guests that are joining us tonight. I feel like I want to start out by saying it's been a quiet week in Lake Wobegon. It's been a quiet month for the adjunct faculty group. Our reps are taking the month off, but the leadership team has been working on different things behind the scenes. Our leadership team has been working primarily right now to assess what's worked well in the past year for our representatives and for AFG as a whole, as we have been trying to restructure to make it a more holistic and successful and integrated group. We found that we had great success this year in giving more time at our meetings for our reps to share what they've been working on rather than me spending the time talking about meetings that I've gone to. I can give them that in a report. And we found that by having that share time with our reps, it's been inspiring other reps to say, oh, we should be doing that on our campus, or we want to do one of those events. And so we are realizing that that's a more important part of our meeting because it encourages and inspires people to go out and do more on their campuses. One of the things that we are planning on with in our behind the scenes meeting right now is we're going to be meeting with our teams of reps from each college that come in to find out how better to accommodate different personalities, different achievements, different ways of working so that we can have stronger teams and bring more to our adjunct faculty. We also had another representative step down and again proved our point that our ranked voting worked well. We were able to seamlessly again fill our position with that, and the new rep coming in is thrilled to have the opportunity. So we will have another new representative with Estrella. Our handbook committee, and we have had success. We had approval on our handbook. We just found out today that Chancellor Gonzalez has given her our approval. So we're pleased to share that out with everyone. And we're also continuing our discussion with how best to transition our relationship with our advisor, Gail Haas, and working on that. And almost we have a few more things that we have to handle, but I think we're going to be able to make a good transition so she can help us bridge the next couple of months to take over her tasks. We also have, I've been behind the scenes, although the rest of the group has been taking the month off. I've been busy writing proposals, going to meetings, and working with other people to get things done. We just found out that one of our summer committee proposals has been approved. So we'll have 5 of our reps working as beta testers, basically. Patty, is that how you call it? Yes, beta testing, sort of, for our faculty onboarding, and which will be a great thing. We've got a couple of them that are really excited about working on those committees. And then lastly, one of our other successes is we just had several town halls at the beginning of June dealing with question and answer and clarification about compensation changes to different programs, FPG and eligibility, and they were quite lively sessions, I will say. And so we are happy that we were able to give more information, and we had a wonderful team that helped me. Kudos to Frank and Megan and everybody else on the team. So that's pretty much my report for today. And I'm excited for my next board meeting in 2 weeks with my adjunct faculty group to get them started on our new year's worth of work. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Next, we have a staff representation update with Ms. April Rowland and Mr. Jason Rich.
Good evening, Dr. Narini, governing board members, Chancellor Gonzalez, and members of CEC and guests. Next slide, please. We have a couple colleges we want to let you know of our staff reps this last year. Tracy Denton from Estrella Mountain Community College, Ty Ferguson. Next slide, please. Harry Hurley, Lyle Barnett, and Henry Ezagari from Estrella. Next slide, please. From Chandler Gilbert Community College, we have Mark Shelfuskowski, Senator, Bethany Crosley, Timothy Lesbrun, Dugan. Next slide, please. And Martin Franco, and Stephen Reynolds is a sworn officer. Next slide, please. And as we are changing into our new fiscal year, this is our co-president changes. Our exempt president, Calvin Davala, is exiting as co-president. And Jason Rich is coming in for the next 2 years as the exempt co-president. Non-exempt past president Shannon Manji. I will remain here as a non-exempt co-president for 1 more year. And the next president-elect will be determined by this fall. Next slide, please. We want to thank Calvin Duvall as our outgoing president. He did a wonderful job these last couple of years, even though he's been involved in staff representation from the beginning, but he did a lot of great work, and we want to give them a huge thank you. Next slide, please. And thanking our past president, she's going to be continuing past president because Calvin Duvall is going to be going for his doctorate degree this coming fall and taking a sabbatical. So thanking Shannon Manji for stepping in again for another year and supporting us as past president. Yes. Next slide, please. I want to thank Patty Kirshner, our outgoing VP. She's in our audience tonight. Patty, if you want to stand up. Thank you for all your hard work this last year, Patty. Next slide, please. And a quick election timeline. So we started the election process in March of this year, and we wrapped it up in June of this year with our onboarding. And I want to personally thank Dr. Thor and Marie Sullivan. She came, they both these ladies attended our training on June 13th and answered a lot of questions. We had a lot of fun with Robert's rules within our, within our training. So thank you both. We had a great time.
We were told it was the highlight of the training. So next slide, please. So to show a little wrap up of how the elections actually plays into the district, you probably saw the this structure that was presented at last month's meeting. Next slide, please. Specifically, we're broken up into three councils, non-exempt, exempt, and sworn officers. So each unit, which is the college and district office, each put forward three non-exempt, three exempt, and one sworn officer. Since district and Rio share within, there's actually only 10 sworn officers. Next slide, please. So we want to thank the 44 reps who served in some capacity. Some served for the entire year, some served for the first or the second half of the year. Next slide, please. There's actually a slight error in the count. So we actually have 37 that are returning that have served in some capacity in the past from our different colleges. Next slide, please. We also have 27 new reps coming in. So that's giving us a lot of new voices in there to help continue on conversations. Next slide, please. So a few of the things we wanted to highlight that have happened over the last year is we were part of working on adding additional 8 hours of personal time for diversity, inclusion, and so that people could take a holiday that meant something to them, whatever was most important to their culture. We've been working with a lot of different committees to continue work in the district. And so you can see there's a highlight of some of the high level committees. We've also worked on a lot of hiring committees to try and fill vacancies in our district. Next slide, please. One of the things that we've been doing is trying to work on advancing staff policy. So you guys have all been reviewing the policy proposals that came out of our staff policy collaboration team. And we've been meeting in retreats this month, getting ready for the next year so we can get the next cycle of policies to you. Another thing that we've been working on this year is starting what we call SOPAC, which is a Standard Operating Procedures Advisory Committee, which is really working with HR, faculty, and staff to make sure that we're using shared governance approach to our procedures. And one of the things we just finished up is a staff policy priority survey, where we went out and surveyed all of the staff in the district to find out what it is from them they feel we need to focus on. So we've used that to advise all the work. And that's the end of our report. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Dr. Norini, can I ask a question?
Sure.
Do you guys have, this is a lot of people.
Yes.
Do you have all of them at your meetings?
We do all of our meetings virtually.
Oh, okay.
We try to have one where we do it hybrid each month and try to get people together. But we do it all virtually. We meet twice a month for each council. We also meet twice with joint. And yes, but we don't necessarily always have everybody there every time. We try to make sure we have quorum, but lots of different voices from around the district. And yeah, it is a lot of people, but it still represents less than 1% of our staff base.
I'm thinking that's a lot to manage, all those people.
It is. We have our big Thursday joint council meeting where we're combining this last year's reps. It's 101 people. I don't know if all of them will be there because there's a lot of vacations going on. However, yeah, so, and then new reps coming in. So it's going to be an exciting time.
Wow. Okay, hats off to you guys. That would be a lot of work.
You can see why Robert's rules is important.
Yes, yes, definitely. Yeah.
Thank you so much. Next, we have Emeritus Awards and Recognitions. And while we have plenty of faculty and staff who are worthy of an award or recognition. There's none that we're going to be recognizing tonight. Moving on to the Chancellor's report, Dr. Gonzalez, we are ready for your report.
Thank you, Dr. Narini. Dr. Narini, members of the board, and everyone in attendance tonight in person and virtually. My report will be somewhat brief, just to give you a few items to think about here. Mostly around the major accomplishments. The system-wide strategic plan report was submitted to the board members on May 23rd as a part of my evaluation process. And as outlined, we've made significant strides on several fronts to advance the strategic directions of the system. Additionally, a summary of system-wide highlights from the year was shared, demonstrating how our system is at the forefront of student success, innovation, and leadership excellence across the nation. And based on a substantive written report provided, we will not share a Q4 update this evening as it would be duplicative information. An addendum to the report will be provided in July to formally update through the end of the academic year, as many goals have a June 30th completion date. For Chancellor's goal update, with the commitment to the growth and development of our employees, I'm pleased to report on one of my goals from 2022-23, the design and implementation of a leadership institute for emerging and current leaders in our system. The Maricopa Leadership Institute pilot program, Actualizing Leadership, is an 8-month program that begins with a 4-day intensive experience followed by 7 monthly sessions that prepares individuals aspiring to advance their leadership skills in the Maricopa system. The pilot launched on June 5th, 2024 with 14 participants. The cohort structured program provides participants with practical real world experiences aligned with the American Association of Community Colleges leadership competencies. Our participants will develop a comprehensive understanding of leadership roles, responsibilities, and skills necessary to lead in the community college landscape, and particularly here in Maricopa. This is the first of a 4-tiered learning and development program with additional opportunities coming in the fall. So overall, this was a couple of things here. One was to embrace this philosophy that we will do our best to grow our own. And two, just sort of embracing the fact that we have an interim leadership as a part of our culture. And if we're going to use an interim leadership model, then we need to make sure that we have a strong bench of people that are ready and have the experience and then clearly have the training through these sort of leadership programs to be prepared to step into those leadership roles. So we're really excited about this program. And I want to thank everybody who's been involved in the development of this program, and also to our 14 inaugural participants. For enrollment, right now, summer 2023 in week 4, headcount is up 8.6% over 2023 summer. And for the fall semester that is approaching, we're 9 weeks away. We're up 6.1% from this time last year. And it's a little too early to calculate FTSE projections, but we'll be getting those to you as quickly as possible. But really excited about the summer numbers, excited obviously about the fall numbers as well. And hopefully we'll maintain that and maybe even see a slight increase between now and the start of the fall semester. As for a legislative update, the legislature passed the budget and concluded its work on Saturday, June 15th. In a year with steep and sweeping cuts, our team fought hard and succeeded in preserving the central funding for dual enrollment scholarships, nursing, and adult education. Through our effort, the legislature also established the Community College Promise Scholarship Program, and we are excited to seek partners and funding that important student support. So congratulations to the legislative team and everyone who worked behind the scenes to ensure that we had some wins despite the many financial losses across the state. And then for my partnerships update, the College Promise National Convening was hosted at South Mountain Community College on June 5th. And I was able to provide remarks at the inaugural event that brought together educators, including many of our college presidents and governing board members, in addition to advocates, policymakers, and philanthropists, philanthropists from across the U.S. to share on successful policies and practices that have been implemented throughout the region. The successes of our various College Promise Program initiatives spearheaded by the foundation in partnership with local municipalities was part of the conversation. So Dr. Narini and members of my board, that concludes my update for this evening. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Any questions for the chancellor? Next, we move on to citizens' interim. This is an opportunity for members of the public to address the governing board. In compliance with the open meeting law, the governing board will neither discuss nor take action on issues raised during this portion of the agenda. When necessary, issues will be taken under advisement and placed on a subsequent agenda. Presenting concerns to the board and the free expression of ideas should be communicated with decorum and respect. Uncivil or disorderly conduct is not permitted. The use of diversive or insulting language or the direction of remarks that defame, attack, or harass an individual may serve as cause for the board president or me to direct that speaker immediately conclude his or her remarks. Ms. Macia, do we have any public comments? No public comments. So we'll move on to the consideration of the consent agenda. We now move to the consideration of the consent agenda items. All items under this section of the agenda are consent matters unless they are removed from the consent agenda at this time. Do any board members or the chancellor wish to remove any items from the consent agenda? Is there a motion to approve the consent agenda?
Dr. Narini, I move that we accept the consent agenda as presented.
Ms. Sullivan, thank you. Is there a second?
I second.
All in favor, say aye.
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 Those opposed? So it passes 5-0. Oh, and the student board, with the student advisory board vote approval. Board members, please remember to sign the adopted version of the budgets for our charter schools tonight before you leave. Now on to the non-consent agenda. Second read and adoption of staff policies proposals regarding salary administration, A-41, A-42, classification of employee mobility, C-9, reduction in workforce. Are there any questions from the board members? Hearing none, is there a motion that we adopt the following staff policies as presented? Salary administration A-41, classification of employee mobility A-42, and reduction in force C-9. A second?
I'll second.
Okay.
You're pretty quiet down there.
Yeah.
You two are just doing so well.
Well, you know, somebody has to do it.
Yeah.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? So by a vote of 5 with a student advisory vote, they have been adopted as presented to us tonight. Next, we move on to first read and information items, employment and separations, April 20th, 2024 through May 17th, 2024. Board members, are there any questions? Moving on to monitoring reports, budget analysis report, Fund 1, general unrestricted funds for the 11 months ending May 31st, 2024. Board members, are there any questions? Moving along, community linkage, Mr. Burnett, your last meeting. Do you have anything to report?
Well, I attended a couple of graduations. The Rio Salado High School graduation, it was fantastic. And I also attended the Juneteenth celebration at Mesa Community College, which was, I ended up talking to a couple of people that worked for the high school district and gave one of them your name because he's a great guy that I think you and him would have a lot in common and a lot to talk about. And then other than this board meeting, that concludes my report.
Thank you so much.
I'm on the board.
It's been a pleasure having you on the board.
Been a pleasure being here.
Let's see. Ms. Bittersmith hasn't joined. Have you joined us yet? Nope. Okay, Ms. Butler.
I have no report. Thank you.
Ms. Davis.
I attended the Rio Salado community or high school equivalency graduation as well. I sat next to this gentleman over here and every student that walked across that stage, I kept thinking, I wonder what their story is. There are some powerful stories in that graduation. So I'm really thankful I had the opportunity to come. And other than that, I just want to tell everybody to have a great July. I already did my summer vacation, but you guys have a great vacation and we'll see you in August. And that's all I have.
Thank you so much, Dr. Thor. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Sullivan.
Okay. All right. So I know we're all anxious to move on, but I have a list that's this long. No. So first, I'd like to say hello, Dr. Gonzalez. Glad to hear your voice. I also started the month by attending the Secretary of the U.S. Department of Education Behavioral Health gathering that was held at South Mountain. Appreciated the opportunity to be at South Mountain, and thank you for hosting us, Dr. Daniels. I attended the strategic planning piece, and thank you, Ms. Hernandez and Jake Harmon, for putting that together. I also went to the staff representation event that we talked about, and Linda and I had an absolutely great time. I'm speaking for you, I apologize. We were called out for being a really fun dog and pony show. Someone did come up to us and say that if we were, if board meetings were as fun as what we presented, that they would be more than happy to be here periodically. So, so anyway, thank you to you, Jason and April, for hosting us there. I also attended the HSC graduation. My comment there is they gave me a script for what to say, and Kate Smith took the first part, Tom Horn took the second part. So I had to make something up on the fly. So, oh, well, but anyway, that was fun. And to Ms. Davis's point, it's a very poignant graduation. You imagine the stories. There are young people that walk across the stage. There are older people that walk across the stage. You know that they've had a variety of experiences, some just eager to get that high school diploma, and others who have struggled for years to find that achievement. It truly is a remarkable representation of one aspect of what we do. So thank you again for being, for allowing me to be there. I have two other pieces. One comment, I read that the Arizona Town Hall is being absorbed by us in the community college system. Being a member of the town hall, I find that pretty exciting and look forward to many opportunities to participate. So thank you for your leadership there. That's wonderful. The other, I'd like to comment on Mr. Burnett's work with us and your departure. You know, every once in a while you find a colleague that you not only find interesting, but also worthwhile of the relationship to work together on a shared mission. And so thank you for your contributions to the district, to the governing board. And I wish you the best as you move forward and come back and see us, because again, we hear that we're kind of fun. So we'd love to see you, but thank you again for that.
Thank you, Ms. Sullivan, and thank you for the rest of the board too. So nobody else say anything, please, but thank you.
And my last comment, I'd also like to acknowledge Dr. Carter and wish you the best in your journey to the next step. And we rely on you when you're going to Blue Cross Blue Shield to mention some of our interests to the CEO there, with that egg in your basket. But anyway, wishing you the best. And I think Medicaid and Health Choice are in good hands. So. Thank you for that. And that concludes everything other than to say, have a wonderful summer. If you get to take a vacation, I will. And I'm looking forward to it. But thank you again for all your contributions. This district is alive and well because of you. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Thor.
Well, others have already given my report. As April and Ms. Sullivan indicated, I did attend the onboarding for staff representation. And Marie, yes, I really did have a very good time. I also attended the Rio High School equivalency graduation. This is one of my favorite events of the year, and is the 27th, 28th high school equivalency graduation that I have attended. So.
Well, thank you.
And I also, sorry, Lynn, but I also want to acknowledge and thank Lynn for his service the last 2 years. You've been a wonderful student representative. And I also want to offer best wishes to Heather Carter as she moves on to her important new role. We only had you 7 months, but it was a great 7 months. So thanks very much. Everybody have a wonderful summer.
Thank you so much. Now it's my turn. I too went to South Mountain to meet with the Secretary Cardona and talk about behavioral health, and was also at the Rio Salado's high school graduation. And the student stories were remarkable. It was their shoes. The shoes, they're just, yeah. But I also was able to tour the IG Holmes Boys and Girls Club, my old club that I first attended. And as many things that have changed has actually stayed the same. I did find my name still, we won't go there. But we talked more about how we might partner. I was excited to hear about what the faculty are doing with the Boys and Girls Club, because they're really interested in partnering with us more with some of the things that they're doing. They'd like to meet at some of our different campuses for their Youth of the Year, so we can get that going. But that, other than that, again, thank Lynn, welcome Ms. T, and everybody else, have a great and cool summer. Let's see, the board, so now that that's over, the board historically doesn't hold business meetings or board meetings during the month of July. Yay. If there's something that does arise that needs our attention, we will call an emergency board member, a board meeting. Otherwise, our next board meeting will take place on August 13th, 2024. That'll be our board retreat from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. Location to be announced, but I imagine it's going to be close to here, because the same day on August 13th, we'll have a gender review at 4:30 here at the Rio Salado Conference Center. August 27th, we'll be meeting back here at the Rio Salado Conference Center at 5 p.m. for the executive session on litigation update and the regular governing board meeting at 6:30. So this concludes our meeting. So thank you everybody for your time. And yeah, and
John. Have the record again.
There you go.
Good night, everyone. Thanks for being here.
So it is adjourned at 7:17.